Thank you very much. I appreciate it. You're very, very kind. Well, I bring you greetings from Atlanta, where I'm from. I live in Atlanta, Georgia. It's going to be a really nice city when we finish it. I don't know the last time you've been through Atlanta, but if you've been through, you notice that highway construction has been going on since the day Sherman left. They started redoing the highways. And they're never going to finish, and I found out why the original plans were lost. And nobody will admit it. So what happens every morning in Atlanta, 6,000 guys in hard hats and buckets of cement go out and just start building stuff. You know, ain't nobody got no clue which way it's going. But it's a great town to live in. I really enjoy it. Politics are really good in Atlanta. I know you have great politics in Louisiana. I was over in Baton Rouge to the show, and they were telling me all about the governor's race and everything. One fellow said that you got a Democratic guy running in the primary, been indicted on a number of occasions, but it said they can't convict him because they can't find 12 people in Louisiana who think stealing's a crime. We got great politics in Atlanta. Let me give you an example. You know, as a newspaper columnist, you've got to keep your finger on the pulse of what's going on in all the country and in your own community. And Atlanta's kind of fun to do because something's always going on with the politicians. Let me give you a good example of how difficult it is for a person in the news media to deal with public officials sometimes. We have a city councilman in Atlanta by the name of James Bond. That's his name. That's not 007. That's James IQ, unfortunately. But regardless of that, James got himself elected to the city council and became the head of the public safety committee. He's in charge of all the law enforcement people. Somebody broke in James' car and stole his car radio. He calls the chief of police of Atlanta, Georgia, and tells him about this, and the chief sends down the head of the auto theft division to investigate this heinous crime. And his chief gets down and he says, I better do a good job. And he begins looking all over the car. One place he looked was in James' car ashtray. And what did he find there? Nine of them. Left-handed lucky is what I'm talking about here, ladies and gentlemen. Somebody been smoking on them. Looked behind the seat and found one freshly rolled. This information came out in the newspaper. I called the chief, said, Chief Napa, Grizzard of the Constitution calling. When are you going to press charges against Councilman Bond for possession of marijuana? He said, oh, we're not going to press charges against Councilman Bond. I said, why not? He said, because there is no evidence to support the theory that the owner of the automobile would necessarily be the owner of the marijuana we found in his ashtray. I said, do what? I said, well, Chief, who you figures in there smoking that dope? He said, I figure it was the thief. This man's a big-time crime buster. The thief, a bad thief, a rookie thief, first time he ever stole anything in his life. What was it going to take him to get a car radio out of a car? 30 minutes? He got time to smoke 9 joints while he's in there? And have the physical power to leave the scene of the crime? What do you do, leave one behind a seat for the next thief? What's going on here? Well, you see my dilemma in trying to write about this thing in the paper. Finally, I said, well, you know, if Councilman Bond didn't do it, I know the thief couldn't have done it. No way. He couldn't have done it. I said, only one other person could be responsible here. The dope fairy. I tell you what kind of town Atlanta is. I got 500 calls next day and one knows, see, how can I find that dope fairy? I'd like to talk to him. Three old girls that graduated from Georgia, same time I did, 1968. All in the Phi Mu sorority. Hadn't seen each other in all these years since 1968. And they met, held a reunion at the Peachtree Cafe in Atlanta, which is in the spiffiest part of town, the Buckhead part of town. And they're there. And the waiter comes, they're dressed up, you know, and I'm trying to impress each other. And the waiter comes out, and what do you have? I just had a salad. She's having a salad. I'm having a salad. If they have a salad, I'm having a salad. I want some white wine. You had that white wine, that salad. Well, they get to having the white wine there, and they start talking. And one of them says, Janice, I ain't seen you in all these years. What's your life been like? She said, it's been magnificent. She said, I am married to an international heart surgeon. We have our own 727. We fly all the world where he lectures. We have a home in London. We have a beautiful place in Maui. We have a marvelous place in Palm Springs. We were with the Reagans the other night, and that Nancy Reagan, I think, is the sweetest person I have ever met. What's your life been like, Bernice? Well, much like yours, she said. My husband's an international businessman. We have our own 727, too. We have a place in Paris. We go to Saint-Tropez skiing. We have a marvelous place in Palm Beach, and I shop on Worth Avenue, and we were the Iacocas the other night, and I think they're the sweetest people I've ever seen in my life. And there sat Hilda. And I said, Hilda, what's your life been like? She said, well, nothing like yours. I mean, that's really something. I just married old Joe Jones out of college. And we ain't got the nicest trailer in Dothan, but it's pretty nice. And, you know, Joe cuts meat down there at the Winn-Dixie. You know, we took the kids to Opryland last year and got to meet Minnie Pearl. It's pretty exciting. And he said, Hilda, we can't believe this. You were everything at Georgia. You were the homecoming queen. You dated the captain of the football team. Isn't there anything extraordinary about your life? She said, well, the only thing I can think of is when my husband, Joe, gets sexually aroused and has an erection, we can put 13 parents like that. They said, how many? She said, 13 parents. Well, they continue to have a little salad and drink the white wine and everything, and then the truth starts to come out, the more white wine they got. And finally, the first girl said, listen, I was just trying to impress y'all. My husband's not an international heart surgeon whatsoever. He's a veterinarian. We live in Maryville, Tennessee, and we got to go to Gatlinburg last year and took the kids to Dolly World. They were really excited. The other girl said, well, you know, that's sort of like me, so I'll lie to you, too. My husband's not an international businessman at all. He runs a state farm thing, you know. We went over those arcs last year and saw Dog Patch USA, you know. And he looked at Hilda and said, Hilda, we want to tell you how much we appreciate you telling us the truth, but was there anything you might have exaggerated about your life? She said, the only thing I can think of is not every time, but sometimes. When we put that 13th parrot right there on the end, it has to flap his wings to stay on. Thank you.